Richard! Hey, dog, congratulations, dog. Hey, I heard you won MVP for Monday Night Raw. Dog, I didn't even know they had an MVP.
Yo, YouTube, what is up? Radar 25 back again. My co-host, Michael Funtamania.
What up, Marks?
Guys, it's the go-home episode of Monday Night Raw. Extreme Rules is this Sunday. We're dropping this video. We got three takeaways for you guys from Monday Night Raw. Eh, of a show. It wasn't all that. Got a couple nice returns, but that's pretty much it. Not a lackluster show. The feuds going into Extreme Rules aren't, like, really... you know, really pulling you in. Really bad rating for this Monday Night Raw as well.
Second worst of all time.
Second worst of all time, which is not good. We'll see where they go from here with Extreme Rules being this Sunday and how they plan out and who wins those matches. We'll have the predictions for you for Extreme Rules on our Friday Night SmackDown takeaway video coming later this week. Guys, but I want to remind you guys to drop a like on this video, previous videos, hit the subscribe button. If you're not subscribed and you're watching, notification bell so you guys aren't missing anything when it drops. Follow the social media, the Twitter, the Instagram, follow the Twitch for the live streams. All that pop on the screen right now. Without further ado, let's jump into the video, our takeaway video, three takeaways from the go-home edition of Monday Night Raw with Extreme Rules this Sunday. All right, guys, so Monday Night Raw started off with the MVP Lounge. It's been a few Monday Night Raws where, you know, the MVP Lounge has been a thing. MVP is prominent on the show with Bobby Lashley. His guest was Dolph Ziggler. More of the same from Ziggler, saying that he takes credit for all that Drew McIntyre has accomplished. It's just same old, not too much to get hyped about the feud. You know, Drew McIntyre does come out and interrupt, and, you know, he gives him kind of sucker punches, you know, Dolph Ziggler.
Glasgow kiss.
Yeah, so he just drops him, and that was pretty much it. You know, they still have yet to announce the stipulation. It's going to be announced the day of Extreme Rules, probably right before the match. They'll announce what stipulation it's going to be. But, yeah, the feud that was – we were kind of excited for, not so much anymore. I mean, it has the potential for the match to steal the show, but as a feud, nobody really cares anymore, even if it's for the WWE Championship.
Yeah, they dropped the ball, and this is really underwhelming how it's just – it's been the same thing over and over. It hasn't evolved. It's just, I made you, and, like, you know, you're just being a dick and never gave me any credit for it. It's like, okay, blah, blah, blah. They add to it, and then usually Drew just knocks him out and or moves on. So it's kind of whatever. But like you said, they could definitely steal the show. They're probably going to be the best match on the – you know, just we wish that there was more behind it, more meat on the bone. And there just really isn't.
Well, you see that they're keeping MVP and Bobby Lashley around Drew McIntyre a little bit, especially in this episode. They had him show up in the MVP lounge, Drew McIntyre, and then they had Drew McIntyre in the background while they were interviewing MVP and Bobby Lashley. Sarah Schreiber immediately went to Drew McIntyre, who was behind them, to interview him. So, you know, just teasing a little bit that, you know, that feud's going to come back. But it is what it is right now. We'll see how that match goes on Sunday. The next thing on the show was a tag team elimination match between the Viking Raiders and Andrade and Angel Garza. You know, it's weird because I don't know what it is between the two of these guys, Andrade and Angel Garza, but they strip as the match goes on. Like, they start with T-shirts, and they strip those off, and then Garza starts off with those green pants, and it's weird. And they go to commercial break, and then next thing we see them, they're wearing less clothing.
It's like they're ill-prepared to start the match. They're like, oh, shit, we got to get ready.
Yeah.
There's been a lot of, like, just all over the place with these guys. They were with Randy last week. They're fighting each other 1 week. They're together this week. They're talking to Ric Flair in the back 1 week. It's just, like, it's a lot of, like, we don't know what to do with these guys. We're just going to keep throwing them out. Hopefully they put them as a tag team. That's because the two guys can really be a good tag team with Zelina as their manager. Hopefully they push it, maybe give them the tag team belts or give them a run or something. But enough, like, with the bouncing around and, like, you know, are they boys or are they not? Can they work together? Are they sneaking with Randy? Like, it's just like, I don't know. It's just too much. They're kind of in everyone's storyline, it feels like, at one point. They're involved in someone's storyline. It's just let them have a run.
Well, at first they eliminated Eric of the Viking Raiders, and then Andrade was eliminated, but he helped out Garza later on during a match with interference to help him pin Ivar. So they win, and now they'll take on the Street Profits at Extreme Rules for the Raw Tag Team Championships. I like to see them win because they don't use the Street Profits whatsoever. They seem to be all in on this team. Not all in. They seem to be back and forth, but at least they're always on every single show.
But, I mean, they've been the most, like, since the start of the quarantine Raws and stuff, they've been the most, you know, on multiple segments, multiple nights, and, you know, they're a big part of the of every show, it feels like. So it's definitely give them – they've been used more than, you know, the Viking Raiders or the Street Profits. So let's, you know, like you said, give them a run. I want to see them win. Get something out of these guys.
We'll see what they do with them. But that match will take place on Sunday at Extreme Rules, the horror show. The next thing on the show, and it's finally our first takeaway, number one of the night. And it is the first, let me start off. It's Ruby Riott in the back having an interview. She gets interrupted by the Iconics, Billy Kay and Peyton Royce, who have been having issues. They've both beat Ruby Riott back-to-back weeks in singles matches. Now they're going to have a tag team match. You don't know who Ruby Riott's partner is. I was assuming it was going to be Liv, but it wasn't. It was the returning. This day with number one, remember? The returning.
You're right. I'm the strongest, the toughest, the roughest, the quickest, the smartest. And tonight, I'm going to be the greatest tag team partner.
Bianca Belair. Remember, she came up right after WrestleMania, and she was there for like 2 weeks maybe, and that was it.
Maybe
you never
two,
saw You never saw her half. Again. And, you know, I was excited because – you know, and you can tell by the promo she cut in the back when with Ruby Riott. She just has so much swag to her and so much confidence to her. Plus, she's a tremendous athlete. I would have to say her, Naomi, and probably Charlotte is the three best pure athletes in the women's division. And I don't think it's that close. You know, they're just so athletic. She's so powerful, so explosive. And, you know, interesting to see her come back in this role. But I want to see how they push her later on. This match will leave Ruby Riott versus and Bianca Belair versus the Iconics. They would get the win. Bianca Belair pinning Billy Kay, but it's more just, I think, the return of her, and hopefully they push her or they have her in. Like, I want to see her against Shayna Baszler. I want to see her against Charlotte. Yeah. I want to see her against Sasha Banks, people like that. Yeah.
I mean, she has the talent to be, you know, one of the top women in the division. It's good they're starting off slow. I don't know if I love the whole Ruby thing because you kind of felt like it was going with Liv and now it's not. But start her slow, build her up, you know, steady build, keep her going, and then where she can jump into. Going in with one of the four horsewomen. You know what I'm saying? It's been like, again, this week was the 5-year anniversary of the four horsewomen. We've seen a lot of them back and forth for the last 5 years. It's nice to get some new blood in here, get some, you know, refresh everyone, like get some new rivalries going. So Bianca Belair, hopefully, in, you know, a few months from now or 6 months from now, can be a top woman in the Raw division or SmackDown, wherever she ends up. But, you know, she's, like you said, she's a 5-2 talent right there. Blue chip prospect.
Yeah. I mean, she has the swag, the confidence, the character with the EST of WWE and all that stuff like that. She just has a presence to her, obviously, size-wise and strength and everything like that, athleticism. I mean,
she matches up with anyone.
Yeah, she's big, big, powerful woman, you know, so it's good to see her back. Hopefully they do push her. Like I said, I would like to see her more implemented into a singles run and thrown out there against like the bigger names and the people more prominent in the women's division. Like I said, I would love to see her versus Shayna Baszler. Yeah. And that's a perfect lead in
but
to take away.
In due time.
Perfect lead in to take away number two of the night. We'll start it off before we get into that, you know, R-Truth. He ran into Richard O'Shea and Cedric Alexander in the back, had a little fun with them, and Tozawa. And then he challenged Tozawa, you know, to a match in the ring. They came out, and as Tozawa was out there with his ninjas, the return of another female superstar is takeaway number two. And a perfect lead-in, it is the return of
picking off Tozawa's ninjas. This is the brutality of Shayna Baszler.
Ragdoll and ninjas out here.
Of Shayna Baszler. She is back, and she destroys three ninjas and actually picks one up and yokes the shit out of him and drops him, which is a tremendous display of strength from her. But it's interesting to see, and it's a takeaway because obviously she comes back, but the timing of it is funny because there's a lot of rumors swirling around online that Vince McMahon has soured on her and is not interested in her for whatever reason, and that's why she's been gone this entire time. And it's funny, Vince is so smart that he would maybe he found out this leaked or this rumor was out, you know, and he was like, let's capitalize on it and have her show up.
The dirt sheets.
Now who knows if the rumor was true or if it was false and it was made up.
Most likely think Vince maybe laid it out there. So I mean, WWE just laid it out there.
Could be. Yeah, build
something out of it.
Yeah, because she came back and she got on the mic after she beat up the ninjas and Akira Tozawa, and R-Truth kind of ran in fear and that she's coming for it. You know, she's coming for the women in the women's division. And it's, you know, she was on that. She seemed like it. I mean, she lost to Becky at WrestleMania. Then she came back in the Money in the Bank match, and then that was kind of it. You know, and she was breaking arms going into that Money in the Bank match. She broke two arms of two female wrestlers, and you know, it seemed like that. And she wasn't really like super prominent in the Money in the Bank match. And after that, you just never saw her again.
Yeah,
you know, Becky went away for she came pregnant. Asuka became champion, and that was pretty much it. I mean, you didn't see her after that. And then those are the rumors started swirling around that she's been soured on by Vince McMahon. Vince McMahon is no longer interested in her character and doesn't really feel like she could contribute in a position
which never made any sense because he loves that style and he loves like you know those monsters and that's kind of where how he builds
it. It's the female Brock Lesnar, you know?
Yes, Brock Lesnar.
She could obviously be that.
And a monster heel, this company was built on Hogan and all that stuff, but he always had a monster heel to face. You know what I'm saying? Like his baby face, his best story has been a baby face versus a monster heel, and this is exactly what you have here. You have a Brock Lesnar monster heel that can take out the entire women's division, run the division, and just take out everyone, and she has before. So hopefully, they start building and building and building. I would have done this after Extreme Rules. I feel like the timing is kind of weird, right before Extreme Rules. I mean, like she said, she's not going to have a unless she interferes.
Yeah, so maybe she implements herself directly into that Asuka Sasha Banks match.
But I think it would have been better if she would have, you know, either the day after or at Extreme Rules, she does something to interfere in the match, maybe screws Asuka or whatever, or screws Sasha, whatever the case may be, and then she implements herself in. It's the timing is a little weird, but whatever.
The timing is weird, but I did like what they did where she beat up like three, you know, men and you know choked one out, hit the other one with the knee straight in the face, and then picked up the other one and just dropped his ass. So that I did enjoy because he made it come off like more of a badass. But yeah, the time is a little off because it is the week of Extreme Rules. But like maybe they just want to show her case her as a badass again. Even though everybody already knows she is, they showcase her as that, like beating up these guys, and then she implements herself in the match or after the match happens at the horror show. Extreme
and it was nice to see like an old school just like surprise comeback. It wasn't put on Twitter. It wasn't shown, you know, in advance. It was just like, ooh,
Shayna
we forgot about her and she's back. And even earlier too, just with Bianca, just you know that whole just surprise stuff we used to get back in the day. You know, that was always the best surprise
beforehand because they'll put like for a rating or they'll put like
a
major news outlet like Sports Illustrated reports that this person's coming back and stuff like that. That's why they do it. But yeah, I like to see this. Like I like the way it was done. Timing is strange, like you said, but it's good to see her back and you know she's a badass and it's cool to see her back. But that's takeaway number two, guys. The next thing on the show, and we're takeaways. Third takeaway of the night, and it is a Seth Rollins promo in the ring, which is funny because he himself says that the eye for an eye, he thought, you know, Ray was being, you know, metaphoric with it, and like he didn't think it was actually going to be an eye for an eye. But an interesting thing he says here is that he will rip the eyes from Rey Mysterio's head so that he will not be able to see his son get married. He will never be able to see his wife's face again, and he'll never be able to see a sunset again, which I thought was
Game of Thrones shit.
I thought that was really good on the part of Seth Rollins to say something like that because it makes it even seem more dastardly and evil, and that's what he needs for like that cult type figure that he's trying to be, and he's trying to save Monday Night Raw and you know move it towards the future and his vision and all stuff like that. But funny thing, Kevin Owens does interrupt him, and he says that, you know, Seth, if you lose your eye, no worries. You know, I'll take care of you because I'm good friends with Jean-Pierre Lafitte, and he has an eye patch. And
exactly what you need, because I happen to be pretty good friends with a certain pirate by the name of Jean-Pierre Lafitte, and he gave me one of these for you. He
pulls it out. Obviously, Jean-Pierre Lafitte is, Pierre Carl Ouellet, independent fame right now. So you know he wore an eye patch in WWE.
PCO.
So that was funny. This led into Murphy and Aleister Black, which ended in disqualification. Then it became Seth versus KO. I kind of want to see Aleister Black and KO in different, like a more like solo feuds instead of being just be like guys or like supporting characters in this feud.
Yeah, so a supporting cast.
They're like for some reason they're like they just want to help Ray out, and that's like you know I think they're better served in other ways, and I think it would help the show out if they were.
Yeah, I mean it would help build storylines, less promos, less that stuff. Right now they're just cameo in this, and you know hopefully they'll once the blow off's over, they'll just do their own thing because they're just so talented. But Rollins and Owens can just have a great match no matter.
Yeah, Owens got the win here.
Yes, the distraction with the distraction from everybody in there. I'm not sure who's gonna win on Sunday. I think it's all points lead to Ray.
Well, no.
I think it has to be Seth. Like Yeah, like I think it's Ray because Ray has to defend his family, his son.
And maybe you know, Seth is taking a hiatus because Becky's pregnant. He wants Becky's to be pregnant. Home. That could but, be that. Maybe he gets an eye ripped out like in some type of weird yeah. gimmicky thing. And then he goes away and he comes back with like a glass an eye or something.
Okay. No, I mean, if they really wanted to go crazy, you know, all points lead to Ray needing to win because it's defend his honor, defend his eye, defend his kids, whatever, blah, 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 right? But if you want to really build the Messiah and like he's the chosen one to take Raw to the next level, whatever the hell that means, him winning, him taking out Ray, him, you know, building this whole persona of the Monday Night Messiah, growing it even more and being like the all leader of Raw, I think it behooves Raw and the WWE to have him win. But we'll see what happens again. All points kind of lead to Ray winning, but I don't know. It'd be pretty interesting if Seth wins and, you know, retires Ray or moves Ray on from here.
They're saying that Ray is no longer under contract.
Yeah, the contract.
I think he's rocking. He's got a classic Vince McMahon handshake agreement that he'll run out Chris the feud. Jericho style. Yeah, he'll run out the feud.
How'd that work out?
I assume. Yeah, that would maybe say Seth wins. Plus, the way things tend to work, the guy who loses the go home show tends to win a pay per view. Yeah. So he lost here. It's a KO. So maybe he'll beat. Rey Mysterio at Extreme Rules, the horror show. Yeah. But we'll see how Dominic plays an effect into this match as well, because he is prominent on the match card. It says, you know, it has Rey Mysterio and Seth Rollins with Dominic in the background behind Rey. So we'll see how he plays in there. Maybe he gets his eye torn out and said, let's see what happens. There's a lot of things they can do. But guys, that's takeaway number three. Next thing on the show, it was R-Truth versus Randy Orton. There was a promo in the back with Ric Flair talking to Big Show. Good promo by Ric because it seems sincere. Yep. And then another tremendous promo from Randy Orton, but there seems to be some type of tension tease between Ric and Randy. We'll see where that ends up. But, you know, this is a squash match. Orton destroyed Truth, and with RKO was going to punt him. Before he punted him, Big Show interrupted. And, you know, another great promo from Randy, and it basically just set up. I don't know why it set up for Monday Night Raw instead of Extreme Rules, but it's an unsanctioned match between Orton and Big Show, which nobody really cares about. But it should be if it's unsanctioned, it should be Extreme Rules. But it is what it is. We'll see where that goes.
Randy's just so hot right now. His 2020 is he's on fire. Everything he does is gold. Even and we all know this is a filler because Edge is hurt, so we're just trying to figure out bodies. We're throwing Big Show and Ric Flair and people just to get stuff going. Why they just didn't have this match on Sunday? It's a non-sanction match. It makes sense for Extreme Rules. You should have Randy on the pay-per-view. It elevates the pay-per-view. No point in having it on Raw the next day. I don't know. Doesn't make any sense to me. But it should be an easy win for Randy. Just take the win.
Continue his head. The legend killer thing.
Let's find another legend. Who else we got laying around in the back and just throw him in there and have Randy punt his head off until Edge is back. Basically, that's what we're doing right now.
That's
and his promos are – you can't miss a promo.
They're A-plus promos.
A-plus promos.
Yeah, but that's what happened there. We'll see what happens with them. Not Extreme Rules, but next Monday. Next thing on the show was Ricochet versus MVP. Nothing to write home about here. More of Bobby Lashley, hitting the full Nelson continuously.
Yep.
It's actually Ricochet versus Bobby Lashley with MVP on the side. Yeah. So Bobby Lashley obviously gets the win here with the full Nelson, and he puts Cedric Alexander in the full Nelson. They continue to build the full Nelson, which is what they should be doing if they want to make it that devastating and eventually going back into Drew McIntyre eventually. But you know, the move makes sense for the guy, but like we've been saying, they just have to continue to build it as a move that nobody can escape. And that's what they're doing, and they're going the right way about it. Pretty much it. But MVP will take on Apollo Crews at Extreme Rules, the horror show, for that new United States Championship. Next thing on the show was the main event, and it's the women's tag team titles match, the Kabuki Warriors versus the Golden Role Models, Sasha Banks and Bayley.
Solid name.
Yeah, good, really, really good match. These teams work well with each other. It's good to see Kairi Sane out there. There was rumors that she was another one that her contract expired, but I think she got a new contract. So a lot going on there. But a really good match. Back and forth. Sasha Banks and Bayley obviously get the win. This is just more hyping up Bayley. I mean, Sasha Banks Sasha and Asuka at Extreme Rules, and also Bayley and Nikki Cross. I could really see, both women having both two titles each. I could really see it happening. It looks like it's going to happen, to be honest with you. It looks like it's going to happen. But I really like the ending where Kairi Sane went for, a clothesline off the ropes, and she got caught with the bank statement. She taps out.
What are you looking for now?
And
bank statement. Oh, and she is folding her hands.
And, you know, the Golden Role Models win the match. Pretty much it. That is Monday Night Raw. Those are our three takeaways. A decent, decent show. Eh.
It was probably less than decent. In fact, there was a couple of things that you were just like, oh, that's interesting. Most of it's for go-home shows used to be really exciting. I don't know if it's just me or it's Lost, but that was always like the best Raw.
Well, it all depends on the fuse. If the fuse are hot, then it makes the go-home show better. Yeah, because you have that final meet up or face to face before the match actually happens. But the feuds are hot, it helps it out. But you know, obviously the feuds aren't that hot.
Yeah, it's supposed to get you excited for Extreme Rules. Are you excited for Extreme Rules after watching this Raw?
I'm only excited for two matches, and that's the Eye for an Eye. Well, I'm three. I want to see the Swamp Fight, Eye for an Eye, and I want to see Sasha win the Raw Women's Championship. Those are the things I'm excited for. But we'll see what happens with them. We could always be disappointed, but it could be interesting. I do hope Sasha wins, and I hope both women have both titles. It'd be pretty cool to see.
And it
would further cement them as the cream of the crop.
And but there'll they be are three the, people, three wrestlers in the company with double belts. That's unheard of.
Yeah, it'll be pretty interesting. But they are the best thing going. Sasha Banks and Bayley. Yeah. You know, everything they do right now is really, really good. Between them two, Randy, Seth Rollins, this is the best stuff going on between Raw and SmackDown. But guys, that's the video for today. Appreciate you guys for watching our three takeaways from the Go Home edition of Monday Night Raw. We'll have those Extreme Rules predictions on after Friday Night SmackDown in that video. But remember, if it was more people, then I'd do the job.
Later, Marks.